wasn't here, but her birthday is Saturday, February 5th. So, we'll see if she comes in, kind of announcements is over, but praise the Lord for today. It's hard to believe that Tuesday's in, you know, January the 1st.
Last two, three weeks
are flown by. But remember, there's no evening service tonight. But remember our New Year's fellowship. We'll be back at New Year's Eve fellowship tomorrow from 8 to 12. You can come for an hour, 2 hours, or stay the whole time. And we'll have food and games, more games. And Elizabeth, you bringing the dominoes? Who's bringing the dominoes? You are? Okay. We just gonna see who the king of the domino board is. Now. What's that, Nick?
Let's have some fun, Pastor Shaw.
Yeah,
the dominoes and everything.
That's exactly right. And then Wednesday we will have service. That's January the 2nd. Wednesday we'll have resume our Bible study and a time of dinner. So those of you who participate, come for that. And then next Sunday, January 6th. Today is just Sunday sing-along, but since we're going to be here tomorrow night for 4 hours, we moved it to next week. So next Sunday is January 6th. Will be fifth Sunday sing-along. And remember to come and participate in that. It is a time of worship. And I have a word of praise, Lord. The boiler got fixed yesterday for a mount that weighed a cost that we thought was going to be in the thousands. It wound up being a few $100s, so we praise the Lord. And that's why everything is warm this morning. I haven't had to go out to the boiler room yet, so praise the Lord. It's the first day in 8 or 9 months, so praise the Lord. I'll be reading Isaiah chapter 7. Verses 7 to 14. And I am going to help with a little interpretation along the way as I read these verses. It will help explain because God is talking, well, he's talking to Isaiah the prophet, and Isaiah the prophet is talking to King Ahaz, and he's made other plans. That's why it's starting with verse 7 of Isaiah 7. It says, "Thus saith the Lord God, it shall not stand, nor shall it come to pass. For the head of Syria is Damascus, and the head of Damascus is Rezin. Within 65 years, Ephraim will be broken, so that it will not be a people. The head of Ephraim is Samaria, and the head of Samaria is Remaliah's son. If you will not believe, surely you shall not be established." Moreover, the Lord spoke again to Ahaz, saying, now what has happened is, Ahaz has made plans behind the Lord's back with Syria and possibly Assyria for plans for survival, for help. God tells them outright that your plan is not going to work. It's going to fail. So hopefully, like us being Christians, if God says, well, your plan is not going to work, that you would listen to the Lord, as he speaks again. And that's what he does. He speaks, verse 10, moreover, the Lord said again to Ahaz, saying, ask a sign for yourself from the Lord your God. Ask it either in the depth or in the height above. But Ahaz said, I will not ask, nor will I test the Lord. So now Ahaz says, well, I'm not going to listen to the Lord. I'm not going to put him to the test. And what he's showing is a lack of faith. So as a lack of faith, God speaks to Isaiah, verses 13 and 14, and Isaiah relays it to Ahaz. I want you to notice how patient and long-suffering God is with Ahaz. And the same thing with us. Then he said, hear now, O house of David, is it a small thing for you to weary men? Or will you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign, behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and you shall call his name Emmanuel. Eventually, Ahaz does not listen to God, even though God told him his plan was not going to work, that God's plan would work. But he refused to listen to God and went his own way. And as we will see, what happens when you go your own way and God has a way. We should acknowledge him in all of our ways. Let us bow our heads toward the prayer. Almighty God, you are a gracious and merciful mighty God. A God who's got us through this year. God who fixed the furnace yesterday. God who holds our lives in the balance of his hand. We praise you and thank you, Lord Father, that you have begun a good work in all of us, Lord. You keep us to the very end. We praise you and love you and lift up your name. Prepare us for even the final 2 days of 2018, Lord, and prepare us for 2019, all that you're going to have for us, the plans that you have to minister to people, to touch people's lives, to help them, and to be used by you, Lord, for your glory, as the wise men sought diligently for you, and over a long period of time, you've gotten to the place that you had planned. Bless all of our hearts here this morning. Let your grace be multiplied to us in Jesus Christ. Amen. Greta finally came into church. See, she tried to get away from us singing birthday songs to her. See, she's got this look on her face like, oh, it's my birthday? Oh, I didn't know it's my birthday. Look at it. Let's give it.
Happy birthday to you. Thank you.
what's in your bulletin. We have a double responsive reading, so let's turn to... Oh, I'm sorry, that's right, 704. Well, I'm announcing it, we will have a double reading, 276 that I will read, and the 283 that we will read as a congregation. But in the meantime, let's turn to 704.
Thank you.
for you, acknowledging not only our need, but you are King of kings and Lord of lords. Bless this offering, Lord. Bless it too. Spread your kingdom, the kingdom of the word of Jesus, as we ask your blessings also upon every heart here. In Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen.
drums, it's number 288. We'll sing the third, fourth, and fifth verses of We Three Kings.
Journey continues. I want you to think. Well, we started in the first Sunday in December, the preparation for the Messiah, and God has prepared the forerunner, He's prepared Mary, prepared the world, He prepared the wise men. And I have to think of all the time that God has put in. I'm going to read verses 1 to 12, Matthew chapter 2. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes and the people together, he inquired of them where the Christ, or the Messiah, was to be born. So they said to him, in Bethlehem of Judea. And the reason why Judea is mentioned twice, once in verse 1 here, because there was a Bethlehem of Zebulun. The Bible is making very clear it's the specific place that God has chosen. So they said to him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, for you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, determined from them what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search carefully for the young child. And when you have found him, bring back word to me, that I may come and worship him also. When they heard the king, they departed. And behold, the star which they had seen in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him: gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Then, being warned by God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed from their own country another way. I mean, from verse 1 to verse 12, you can see God's hand in this whole story. And yet, I don't understand it. I do, because it's a lack of faith and unbelief. But so many people have trouble with the wise men, they have trouble with the star, they have trouble with the gifts, and just this whole story. And the Bible is very clear here what God had done. God had prepared them for their long journey. And it is a journey of faith. And as we will see, and the wise men, and I like that term, because they went looking for Jesus and found him. They were very wise. And so, and remember, this is still part of the Christmas story. Even though a lot of stores have put up their lights and their packages and everything else, some stores still have a few things out. But to them, Christmas is past. But for us who believe, the wise men are still part of the Christmas story.
Amen.
God had planned it this way. God chose to do it this way. I don't know why, but that's what he did. And my first point is the quest of the Magi. That's what the Bible calls them. And they came from the east. It doesn't say exactly, and I think this wasn't too important to God, because people say, were they from Persia? Were they from Babylon? Were they from Media Persia? Were they from even some from India?
Yeah.
Because in church history, one of the three wise men with their names, they believe came from India. Remember, that's church tradition. That's not Bible. But people believe all kinds of other things in dealing with the wise men and the story. But the Bible is very clear. They came from the east. Where? We do not know. Maybe in heaven we will find out if God chooses to reveal it to us. We don't know. But they did come from the east. They came from somewhere and went on a journey of faith. Second point there is, and they knew Jesus as king. I want you to see that. That's important. They knew. Because when they came to Bethlehem, or when they came to Jerusalem and then to Bethlehem, both cities, they were looking for the king. King Jesus.
Yeah.
And when they reported that to Herod, he was disturbed. But they knew that Jesus is king because God somehow got that word to them. How? The Bible doesn't say, just as we will see, the Bible doesn't tell us of a lot of things. It's by faith, as we will see in the second point. But they knew Jesus is king. And I want you to think about that. When they did not even see Jesus, they still believed that he was king. Even when they went to Jerusalem, when Herod, the scribes and the religious leaders, when they didn't believe, the wise men still believed. And just think, when they found Jesus, they still believe. That's an awesome testimony. That's a testimony of faith. And the third thing, they saw his star. Notice what it says there in verse 2. Whereas he was born king of the Jews, we've seen his star, the star of Bethlehem. It led them on their quest. It led them on their journey. It led them to the place God had prepared for them. Just like he prepares places for us. You look back on your life, you'll see the journey of faith from the time you were saved, the places God has taken you, just like I do that, the places he has taken me. I would have never gone to some of those places that I would not have chosen, but God chose. And you've heard some of my testimony from some of the churches where I've been, things that have happened. I would not have done it that way, but God did it that way. He did that way for the wise men, he did it for you, and he did it for me. And that's part of our life of faith. And they saw his star in the east, and they came. And lastly, in verse 11 and verse 8, they worshiped Jesus. In verse 11, it says, and they had come into the house and saw the young child with Mary his mother and fell down and worshiped him. And remember, that's what they told Herod. That's why Herod told them, well, before you go, tell me, report where he is so I may go worship him. They told Herod. Herod was supposed to be the king. But they told him, we're going to worship him. So they worship him. That's what we're doing this morning, in worship time. Through our songs, through our giving, everything we do here, as we listen to the singers, the beautiful words that they sang, and the songs and the words we sang, it's about worshiping Jesus. Along the journey, the wise men, quest of the Magi, they had a long quest. And my second point, and I included this here, faith includes the unknown. Because we don't know everything, and they didn't know everything, because God doesn't reveal everything to us in his plans for our life at any given time. What I mean by that is, they didn't know where they were going initially. They were following the star. And the star led them according to what the scriptures will eventually tell them and us, where he was to be born. But along the journey, I remember going to Bible school. I said, Lord, how am I going to become a preacher when I don't believe in it? I went to a Pentecostal Bible school. I said, I asked the Lord, I said, how are you going to work this out, Lord? I was graduating from a Pentecostal Bible school and I didn't speak in tongues, didn't believe in all these other things that they were doing. I said, Lord, how are you going to do it? And he made a way that I never even thought about. And then when I was there, graduating from there, I said, Lord, how are you going to do it? And I remember everybody was getting churches left and right. And I said, Lord, I'm still here. And guess what? And it takes faith along the journey. And I want you to think about the wise men. Do you think the star appeared every night? I don't know, the record doesn't say, but we know at some times, and maybe it was all the time, the star led them, but just like us, as we travel life, we don't know everything what God is doing. We don't know the people God is going to cross our path. We don't know the plans God has for us, wherever he's leading and guiding us, just like the wise men. They didn't know exactly where they were going. They knew they were following the star, but wherever it went, they followed. And that's important about faith. And notice I put in the outline there, and I want you to think about Zacharias and Elizabeth, Mary and Joseph, Simeon, Anna, and a number of other people that were faithful. The shepherds, the wise men. But also notice I put Ahaz. And I want you to think, Ahaz from Isaiah chapter 7, he didn't believe God. Herod didn't believe God where the king was to be born, or the Messiah. King Jesus. The scribes didn't believe. The religious leaders didn't believe. Because nobody went. Yeah. I wonder if the wise men said, I don't know why nobody's going. So there are people that see the signs of God, and there are people that see the signs of God don't believe. There are people that believe. You can see in this story, those in the Christmas story of belief who respond to God's sign. God doesn't give every one of us signs all the time. Sometimes he didn't give anybody any signs except for the gospel message. Remember, the wise men found out to go to Bethlehem because the scripture said, and the star went that way. The star was verifying scripture, what God had already planned. I want you to think about that. But there were people that didn't believe it. Can you imagine? I bet Herod, religious leaders, and the scribes, oh, you saw a star. Oh, okay, yes, yes. It's just like somebody said, you know, I saw an alien spaceship. And it, you know, Bill and I attempt to believe in that. But if somebody said they saw a spaceship, to me, I said, well, okay, tell me what you saw. Okay, let's go sit down. Okay, you know, and you think, wow. There's sometimes you think, wow, what did you actually see? I mean, people, but I want you to think of dealing with belief and unbelief. There are people that didn't believe in God for signs, and our faith, that's why I have no trouble believing the Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. No matter how impossible it appears to be, even in the commentaries I've read, some of them are conservative. Most people, I only read conservative books. Some people believe it was a certain star. There was a certain alignment of the planets. But you know what disavows all that? Because stars and planets keep moving. The star of Bethlehem, Jesus' star, came to a stop. Stars don't do that. They keep moving unless God's hand is upon it. And as I said at the beginning of the sermon, from verse 1 to verse 12, I mean, you see God's hand on him, all this whole story of the wise men. I love wearing that sweatshirt. Wise men still seek him. And if you come to the place of understanding the scriptures and your eyes are open, you will become wise. Because what happens is it's unbelief or belief. That's why the stores are packed up. That's why the stores to most people, Christmas is over. But to us who know and who believe and understand the truth, and who believe the truth, we have seen the signs. And I want you to think about this. The wise men are a testimony to us. Just like Moses and Joshua, Paul and Peter, all the saints in the Old Testament and New Testament, the things that they did and accomplished, whether it be Samson, whether it be King David against Goliath, God does the impossible, and he does things his own way. And just like this story, this is part of the Christmas story. God chose to do it this way. Somehow he got the message. Now, me personally, I believe that he might have used Daniel the prophet, his writings and his recordings and he written down. Maybe, I'm not sure, the Bible doesn't say. It doesn't say where these wise men came from, just the east. When you go east, and this is a big, just like in our country, if we say go west from Troy, well, that's thousands of miles. Thousands, not hundreds. If you go to Hawaii, Alaska, it's even further than that. You say, wow, the east. That's a long, it is, it's a long way. Where? We don't know. But God had planned this. And I want you to see behind this God's preparation for those who believe. Ahab, it was remarkable. And that's why I put it in the outline there. God was patient and good to Ahab. He almost, it appears, gave him three chances. Because God spoke to him three different times, and he refused to believe. I want you to say, you make plans, just like I am. I made plans, and then God tells me, your plan is not going to work. I would definitely make another plan. And it would have to be the plan that God told him. And God told him, and he refused to listen. He refused to believe. An unbelief. And I was talking to a Muslim at a gas station this week, and he didn't believe that Jesus was God. I said, well, Jesus is God, that's why we have Christmas. He said, oh, no. And then he went on to try it, and I was presenting him, talking about, I used some scriptures. But he didn't believe, but he's a friend of mine, and we converse about this.
Yeah.
I pray that the word, that God will use the word of the Lord has been planted, and he tries to still convince me that Jesus isn't God, but I know because my faith dictates, my faith tells me because Jesus is King. The wise men knew that. The wise men knew a lot that other people didn't know, and they should have. And thirdly, their quest continues. verses 9 to 12, he says, when they heard the king, they departed and went, and behold, the star was hidden. The star reappeared and guided them according to what scripture had said. Now, what do you think about it? The wise men, I mean, Elizabeth, and the rest of them, Zacharias, Mary, and Joseph, the whole other names that are mentioned in Luke chapter 1 and here. And the star went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced because God had given them a sign. The scripture still guides people to Jesus today. Still guide them. If you use the scriptures, if you use something else, you will lead them someplace else. That's why the scriptures are so important for us to know the scriptures. And I want you to think, I put in there the gifts of faith because it mentioned there, the latter part of verse 11. They presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. I call them the gifts of faith. That's what Christianity, think of it. Gold, the medal of kings. How did they know that Jesus had the right to reign as king? God got the message to them. Now, whether they completely understood, I'm not sure. All I do know is like Abraham saw the day of Christ, he understood some things about Jesus. Did he understand everything? Probably not. And probably just like the wise men, the gift of kings. They knew that baby Jesus was King of Kings. And then they presented to him in frankincense. And that's used with some of the sacrifices. And thanksgiving and praises offered in the Old Testament. So guess what? They were worshiping him. God had prepared them not only to bring these gifts, but to worship him.
Yeah.
And then the third gift. How did they know? The gift of myrrh. That's the gift of death. It was used for embalming. It was very bitter. Tasty. He wanted to taste it. Very bitter. So people didn't taste it. They knew. They knew something about the cross. Did they think it was the cross? Probably not. But they understood that something about the gifts. They're gifts of faith. It's like, and they found Jesus. The scriptures, the star of Bethlehem, you want to call Jesus a star? Same. They found Jesus. And that's what worship is all about. Worshiping him. And if you don't know him, finding him. Finding Jesus, that babe. And a lot of people just have trouble with that. And notice at the end of, in verse 12, the Lord still involved. Then being warned by God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed to their own country another way. They returned another way. And that's what happens when you come to find Jesus. When your eyes and heart are opened up, guess what? I remember that day, November 3rd, 1974, I never walked back that same path I had walked. Sometimes Satan tries to get you to leave back. And that's when they're on that journey. I want you to think the journey of the wise men. Just think, if there was a night the star didn't shine. And just like faith in general, sometimes you don't see, you don't understand that as you're journeying the journey between Satan and this world, you will be attacked and your faith won't understand. Why did this happen? Why did this happen to me? What all this about? We won't understand. But the journey is to keep going because it's by faith. Just like the wise men. The wise men are a memorial to us to teach us. And it was a long journey. And I bet there were times they thought maybe the star doesn't shine. Because when the star reappeared to them after they left Jerusalem, they were rejoicing greatly. I mean, that's what the words were saying. And they were happy. The star appeared. Not knowing, not going, just like going to Bible school, seminary, or going to a new job, or doing this, graduating from school, or going there. I mean, it's scary. But it's a journey of faith, because everybody has to do it. A journey of faith. And it takes time. And time is what we don't have. But notice as I conclude, Isaiah 30, 21, in the middle of that verse, it says, this is the way, walk in it. Then John 14:6, Jesus said, I am the way. Greek doesn't imply, it literally says, it is an impossibility for you to come to the Father outside of Jesus Christ. And 80% of people in churches this morning believe you can do it another way. I want to think about that. But the scripture says, there's a way. This is the way, and walk in it. And what does the Old Testament teach us, and even the New? Acknowledge God in all of our ways.
Yeah.
Not most of the ways. Not in some of the ways. He says, acknowledge God in all of our ways. Because sometimes we have a different way to walk, don't we? Sometimes God says, do this, and I say, well, what's this side of the street? I haven't been on that side of the street. And I see it all the time in Christians' lives. People make wrong choices. One day they make a good, great choice, and guess what they do the next day? They wind up making a bad choice. We all do it. It's happened to all of us. Including me. He said, how does this happen to me? Because we have to acknowledge God in all of our ways. This is the way to walk in. As I conclude, next Sunday's sermon is going to be from Matthew 16. Are you prepared for 2019? I want you to read that chapter. God is going to talk to you. Are you prepared for 2019? Just think, there's only 2 days left in 2018. It's hard to believe it came this fast. The last 2 weeks have just flown by. But God wants you prepared. Just like he prepared the wise men, as he prepared the world, as in the Roman Empire, and Caesar Augustus, how he prepared Mary and Joseph, how he prepared the forerunner, John the Baptist, Zacharias and Elizabeth, and how he prepared the world for the Messiah. God's done a lot of preparing. Are you prepared? Read Matthew 16. That's where we'll be next week. Prepare yourself for what the Lord has for you. Let us bow our heads as we close in the word. Almighty God, there are many ways we can travel, many paths, but lead us on the path that you have chosen, Lord God. This is the way. Help us to walk in it, as your word says. Jesus is the way, Lord. Help us to follow him. Not to follow ourselves or our thoughts or what we think is best, but what Jesus knows is best for us, his way, Lord Father. Prepare our church, Lord Father, that we will be a group of people who humble themselves and look to you and we trust you, Lord Father. And bless this day that's before us and bless tomorrow, Lord Father, that we will rejoice in you, the God of our salvation, that we will keep our eyes upon Jesus. Help us, Lord. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. As we stand and sing,
596.
Number 596. Are you willing to follow Jesus? His way, not your way. She's in charge, but she thinks she's not in charge, but she's in charge of that, so we can have someone tell people what we want, everybody bring in pop, chips, maybe the other things. So talk to her if you have a question. Let us bow our heads as we close the word.
Our Father and our God, Lord, we come to you. Thank you again for another Sunday. Last Sunday of 2018, oh Lord. Some started off with us, oh Lord, we're no longer here. We pray, oh Lord, that you bless and comfort those who are still grieving and hurting, oh Lord, that come with smiles.